and I see at least one of my patients over there, and I'm so happy about that. That at least we have one representative from our sarcoidosis clinic here. What I do is I have a clinic over there. We established in University of Miami for the first time. And before that, I moved from University of Illinois at Chicago, I mean University of Illinois, UIC. And that was a place that I was trained and first time really understand sarcoidosis with Dr. Swice, that maybe some of you already met or you know about her. What I'm supposed to talk to you guys, and probably I can entertain you a little bit, is talk about what we have in sarcoidosis. Before that, my conflict of interest, I was funded for research by Bernie Mac Sarcoidosis Foundation and Madden Croft, and hopefully very soon with FSR, and that's gonna be a new project that we are cooking. What we're gonna talk today, I'm gonna talk to you a little bit regarding epidemiology of disease and clinical presentation, that is what we're that all you know. Maybe I can give you a little bit, maybe twist on your knowledge here. Sarcoidosis, all we know. All my patients, first day, at least I have witness here, gonna meet a very close friend. Her name is Nancy. Nancy is a poster, gonna tell you all things about galomatosis disease and organ involvement. Whenever that you are talking about this structure, it's very important to understand. Because whatever that we are doing, all medications, whatever that we're gonna do for you is based off immunology and pathology of this specific structure. And then probably you know that 90% of the involvement gonna happen in lungs. I have many patients with brain or heart and other organs, but if you go after and do imaging, you can find some evidence for the lung involvement. But maybe a stopping earlier stage, but other organs progress, but some of them gonna be progress, but I see some patients here on oxygen. Then the epidemiology of the disease is kind of interesting too. Significant disparity exists. Why it is? We know that in general, that gonna be based on 100,000 population in the United States, but in the same time, really is more in African American compared to European American. And why this happening and why we have this issue, it is something that we're gonna discuss very soon about that. Second thing is location. Unfortunately, we are in the place that sarcoidosis is more common compared to west side of United States. Means don't expect a lot of patients in California, but we have a lot here. Is there something going on in the environment? Is there something that we should be aware of? Is there something that we can prevent of it? All those questions, as a researcher, I need to ask and figure it out. And as a patient, you need to ask your doctors that, what's going on? Why is this happening to me? And then many patients ask me, what's gonna happen to my kids? And the answer is really, we don't have that much genetic association gonna happen in the next generation. That 17% or 6% that you can see, like other diseases in normal population. So the very kind of straight answer is, if you have sarcoidosis, the risk for the next generation is not that high. And it's like other people. Then after that, that we talk about the environment, you're gonna ask me that, okay, so people, there are a lot exposed in this part of the nation to many things that you think. Why me? And that is a very relevant question too. So the theory that we are putting together is, should be some genetic susceptibility in your immune system that after exposure to that, whatever we call, can end up to this disease. It is very simplified of whatever we are seeing. Then, probably you and other people heard about that. We don't know what is the etiology of disease. We don't know why this disease can start it. However, it doesn't mean we don't know anything.
At least in my clinic, out of 200 sarcoidosis patients, I have more than 30 patients that work with cement, with dust. And that is, I have a patient that is artist and grounding glass, end up with sarcoidosis. As very honored physician in veteran system, I have many people from Gulf War veterans that end up with sarcoidosis, and what they have, they've been exposed to dust storms. So we are learning about that, that dust could be the seed for the dead granulomatosis reaction. And we are learning many other things. I have recently, we published a paper on it, cancer cells by itself could be a target. I have patients more than 10 with breast cancers, and after 1 to 2 years, end up sarcoidosis. I have one patient ongoing sarcoidosis, and we had no clue what's happening there, and then we find it out melanoma here, biopsy done and diagnosis made. So that was melanoma-associated sarcoidosis. And many other factors. I have lymphoma, I have patient with colon, and many other diseases that can end up to sarcoidosis. Those were two examples of what we are seeing, but definitely there are different phenotypes that we are learning about this kind of ignored disease. Is this what I would like to call? Then clinical presentation. We know that 35%, usually 30 to 50% of the patients, they don't have any symptoms. But I'm not talking about you guys. I'm talking about 18, 17, maybe 20 years old, usually African-American, going for the service and just take a chest X-ray and say, oh, there's something there. So that is common for those people. And one third of those, maybe they have some non-specific symptoms. And people say, oh, you got cold. But basically that was first presentation of sarcoidosis. And then some of you guys maybe hear about that, Lofgren syndrome. There is some stuff in the legs, and also there is some malaise, fatigue, and lack of energy. And chest X-ray, you can see there is lymphadenopathy that your doctor probably explained to you. And this is another presentation. We have this presentation a lot in Sweden. I saw those patients in France too. Another general word, European-American, usually asymptomatic. And African-American, they have bad disease. Again, this is very general and generic words for me. I don't understand what it is. It's but for all we discuss, but to me, it's meaningless. I have patient, Ashkenazi Jewish, with significant involvement in bone marrow, bone, and other organs. I have more than 25 of those patients in South Miami, and they are not African-American. So those general idea that we are saying is very generic words. I don't think there is any difference between any races for sarcoidosis. Okay. This is another important concept that you should understand. Two-thirds, almost 65-70% of patients, they can improve within 2 years. Means that 30%, they are not. And the question is, who is that 70%, who is that 30%? That is a big question everyone asks me. And the answer is so simple. I don't know. Unfortunately, we don't know. That is the reason we need to figure it out. We need to do many studies to find it out, is there any marker in earlier stage that we can kind of find it out what's going to be prognosis, what's going to end up for that specific. If we can find it out, then we can prevent it of many damage later on. But this is something that we need to learn a little bit more, hopefully in next years. 10 to 30% of patients, they're going to have very progressive disease, and they are not the same. I have a patient with 6 years, very mild lung and eye involvement, and I have another one with 3 years right now involvement for 5 different organs, including eyes, heart, and severe damage in the lungs. So looks like that there is significant diversity in that part as well. And unfortunately, we have 4% of the patients that they're gonna die. And this is a study we have done in 2014, and find out what happened in the United States. Big difference between us and Japan is heart is the main cause for mortality in Japan, but here we are doing very good on it. We use ICD machine that got a fire whenever that heart is not working well, and really we don't have that much involvement in the heart. And then another factor is you can see what's the difference between African American and European American. Again, to me, doesn't mean anything genetics happen. This probably is because of insurance, access to care, and many other factors that can give you this disparity here. And in this one, we try to show that what is the main cause for the death in the United States. We have pulmonary hypertension, we have respiratory failure, and also pneumonia is infection on top of it, but 11% cardiac arrest, and we have some component for the heart failure too. Pulmonary fibrosis kind of adds up to all pulmonary. So in general, lung is the most common cause for mortality. But I'm sorry for my language here. But for that I told you, it's nonsense. Because that is epidemiological study that we are talking about 100,000 blah blah. But I'm really frustrated. I think you are too. You need to ask me, talk to me, my body. I am the patient. Who cares between 100, 30% or 70% gonna improve or not? What about me? And that is the part that is almost 6 years we have been working on it and trying to make it personalized, trying to make it a structure that how we can figure it out about that person as a person. Not as epidemiologic 100,000 numbers. Many of the outcomes that we discussed maybe is not gonna talk about you, and many of your problems probably is not in that epidemiologic studies. So we need to have to personalize medicine to find it out exactly for you as an individual, how we can make diagnosis, how we can improve prognosis, and how we can treat you based off your genomes, proteins, and everything. So, just in general, again general, cardiac 30% involvement, skin 25%, and other organs, emphasize on liver involvement between 50 to 80%. You can see it's multi-organ involvement. Every single part of body can be involved. And nerve in 5%, eyes in 20%, lung 90%, and renal. I have patients with pancreas involvement, I have patients with eye involvement, and at the same time, six other organs involvement, parathyroid and other part of body. So just generally show you some pictures. I think that gonna make more sense compared to talking about medical terms. This is what we talk about. You saw all of them. All right. So, atemporalism. Whenever we are talking about atemporalism, some of you may have or had those nodules, redness in the legs. So this is, I have a patient that discussed about pulmonary sarcoidosis and told me, 10 years ago I had that. And then retrograde, you can figure it out. Or many patients, whenever we discuss those and show those pictures, say, they told me there is just allergy. There is nothing else. It's a bite. But really is a part of sarcoidosis. And then this is another part of skin lesions that can happen in sarcoidosis, usually misdiagnosed. Then this is very common. This is something that I have patients, particularly African American, that there is involvement in the face, some nodules, and maybe around lips, and then that can progress. And sometimes it's very difficult to treat. We call lupus peritoneum, but this is not that lupus disease, it's sarcoid. And this is a very typical case with severe involvement that you can see that all part of the skin, dermis is involved, And sometimes that can involve other parts of bodies too. It doesn't mean always happen in nose and face. This is another case, makes deformity there, and that part of the skin usually gonna end up to scars. Another lupus perineum. Sometimes this kind of raised nodule or skin damage gonna happen, that sometimes you cannot figure it out what it is, and then end up that you can be evaluated by sarcoid expert and tell you that, hey, it is a part of this disease. And even this is another presentation. That many cases could be misdiagnosed because they say, oh, this is not sarcoid. But I can tell you, every single skin lesion, at least in my team, is a part of sarcoidosis unless we exclude it. So we gotta do biopsy, we gotta do everything that we can, make sure that we are not missing diagnosis or mistreated. Eye involvement is very important. That is a part that in our protocol for every patient, without any eye symptoms, every year should be screened. Just take a look, make sure that there is nothing there. And you can see that many things gonna happen. That gonna be involvement in the front or back of the eyes, that retina is a part of it, edema and many other problems can happen. And basically just showing, because many people believe that eye involvement is just uveitis. That is inflammation, I'm gonna show you a picture of it. But a couple of years ago, with a group in Northwestern University, we put together, we look at for entire data from veterans and then figure it out that all part of the eye could be involved. So we cannot exclude any diseases in the eye and say it's not related to sarcoidosis. And probably you heard about uveitis. This is the test that usually we can see. You put your chin there and your doctor gonna take a look with light, and basically we're gonna see this, that basically the organelloma, the same structure that we can find in lungs and other organs. But that gonna be diagnostic of anterior segment uveitis. Then other parts, I have recently, I guess, more than 5 patients with spleen involvement. So that is another part that can be involved. The spleen, liver, if you do PET scan, you can see that significantly highlighted and it's large. And then with other diagnosis that you have, you make it diagnosis on it. And then for the liver, just recently we look at for all patients that we had try to stage it, because the staging for sarcoidosis in the liver doesn't exist. People, I had 3 patients, listen, they told the patient you have cirrhosis, and we don't know why. But that cirrhosis basically was because of sarcoidosis. And all this is painful for me to get the patient whenever end stage is there. Means that liver is already gone, and then what we are doing. And also, another problem is the medications. What medication that you are using? Which one gonna affect the scars in the liver? All those should be considered and at the same time should be evaluated. Many of you complain of body pain, joints, muscle, and everyone just tell you that, fibromyalgia.
Yeah. I
hear that every day.
Yeah.
And I hate it, be honest with you, because that is mislabeling and not understanding whole picture. And whole picture is whenever your sarcoid is active and you produce a lot of proteins that we call cytokines, those gonna give you fatigue, gonna give you pain, gonna give you inflammation. And inflammation, you need to treat it. Not just saying that fibromyalgia, give this medication. That is not gonna work. And you know what I'm talking about. And sometimes, gonna give you a presentation exactly like cancer. Is the type presentation that doctors hear, they know what I'm talking about, is kind of cancer. And people just take a look, oh, you have cancer, you need treatment. Believe me, many times we see patients that label for cancer and end up to us and no, it's not, you don't need chemo, this is sarcoid. And even sinus involvement, maybe that is new for some of you, that pan-sinusitis in sarcoidosis patient maybe is sarcoid, maybe it's not allergic. Maybe we need biopsy, figure it out, and treat them. And brain involvement, recently I have 3 patients with brain involvement, and you can see those opacities that is in the brain, responds very well to treatment. Really, I didn't have any issue with treatment of those patients. And then you can find in a stone, I bet you that some of you had that before, a stone in the kidney is another very common finding, that what can happen is whenever that you have a lot of granuloma and production for the proteins and also some factors that is related to vitamin D, the calcium gonna absorb and end up to the stones in the kidney. And pancreas, recently we had one case, exactly this presentation, because of granuloma inside pancreas. And everyone said, it's cancer, you're gonna die. Lymph nodes in the abdomen is pretty common in our patient. Stomach sarcoidosis can happen. This is another presentation that you should be aware. And colon, let me 1 minute discuss about this. I have 5 patients labeled as Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, and everyone just tried to treat that, but basically it was sarcoid. The thing is, whenever end up to subspecialty, people just seeing based on that specific organ. I mean, GI just looking for stomach or colon, and doesn't care about chest. But if you do chest x-ray, you can see, oh, lymphadenopathy, nodules, everything is there. That is sarcoid presentation. That was a case that we did. In many cases, go after another organ, confirm diagnosis, and say that was mislabeling. It's not Crohn's disease, it's just sarcoid, and treat based on sarcoid treatment. And patient responds very well. Pulmonary, you know about that a lot. Could be different presentation, different symptoms. And unfortunately, at this point, we cannot predict what's going to be the course for the lung involvement. And all of you heard about this, different stages. Funny thing is, this is oldest staging that we are using is 1960s, but still we are using that. That means that in last 50 years, no good study done to find it out new staging. That is the only thing I can tell you. But one is whenever you have bilateral lymphadenopathy in chest x-ray. Second, beside of those lymphadenopathy, you have a lot of infiltration of cells around. And stage 3, you don't have that big lymph nodes anymore, but some scars happen. And stage 4, basically, is a lot of fibrosis and a scar in both lungs. And that is basically in the stage of sarcoidosis. Recently, we reviewed all lung transplant in the United States and figured it out really what happened for sarcoidosis patients and try to come up with the idea, hopefully that paper is going to be published soon, and talking about that, to me, sarcoidosis patients, if they have severe fibrosis and meet criteria for lung transplant, should receive lung transplant in earlier stage because outcome is much better than COPD patients and also other diseases like cystic fibrosis and others. I believe that cystic fibrosis, sarcoidosis, in the setting of pulmonary fibrosis, is a good setting for the lung transplant. And I push for every earlier stage lung transplant. Survival for more than 10 years, I have almost 67%, that is a big number for the lung transplant compared to others. So this is last question that I want to discuss here. People ask me, I'm in stage 2, for example. What is my chance? Again, those nonsense is not personalized. But based on general data, you can expect 40 to 70%. But who is that person? Is it young? Is it elderly? Is it multi-organ involvement? Is it African-American, is it early diagnosed, is it late diagnosed? Many factors can influence on the prognosis of disease that easily those numbers can be biased with a lot of factors that we discuss. And thank you very much.